yet fire-resistant interiors. We are happy to have with us the Director of Delhi Fire Services, Mr. A.K. Sharma. Thank you, sir, for taking the time and being here with us. We look forward to hearing your valuable views on the safety aspect of the interior ceilings, wall systems, and other related products. Mr. Sharma will also be one of the panel members. We're also happy to have with us and welcome Mr. S.K. Nandi, architect Tarun Valecha, who will join Mr. Sharma in the panel discussion. From Knopf AMF side, we have this evening Mr. Andreas Riedel, who is the Sales Director, Asia Pacific and the Gulf Countries, Mr. Stefan Loken, Regional Sales Manager, Asia Pacific and the Gulf Countries, and Mr. Teddy D'Souza, Director, Operations India, and he will also be one of the panel members. Welcome, sirs. We also have with us Editor-in-Chief of Buildotech Magazine, Mrs. Madhura Chandran, along with her team today. Welcome, ma'am. And thank you all for being here today. And before I call upon the panelists to the stage, I request Mr. Andreas to brief us about the latest high-performance ceiling materials and systems.
Welcome. A warm welcome also from my end. It's the first panel discussion for us in this region. It's a new experience, and I'm very happy to be here today in Delhi to give you a short introduction into our company Knauf AMF and give you a brief about our company itself, where we're coming from, what kind of products do we offer, and how these products are used in the buildings. The presentation which I have brought with me today is built up like a train station. We are doing a travel together, so I invite you to travel with me to all the different stops. The first stop will be to show who we are. The second stop will be what we offer. Third stop is what we rely on. Fourth stop, what's new. And the fifth stop, some references combined with pictures. I had a few discussions or a few talks this evening, and not all of you are familiar with AMF as of now, and that's, I think, a good opportunity to give you some more feedback and picture on this. Let's start with our first stop, who we are. AMF is one of the leading manufacturers for mineral fiber ceiling tiles, and we are acting worldwide. We are a member of the Knauf Group. I think Knauf is familiar or known by everybody. It's a family-owned business which has got a turnover of more than 6 billion euros per year and more than 25,000 employees working for Knauf. AMF itself is the ceiling specialist in the Knauf Group, and we are with Knauf. We are with Knauf since 2002. Today, we're providing various strong brands into the different markets, which I will come to later on in more details. Let me start first with a little bit of history to give you more background. AMF itself has got more than 50 years of experience of producing mineral fiber ceiling tiles. In 1963, we started with our own patent to produce the first wet felt manufactured ceiling tiles. In 1970, the company AMF was founded at
premises of our former mother company called Attex. Attex was producing plywood products. And then in 1995, Knauf took over the first 50% of our shares and became owner of AMF. At this time, we had a capacity of about 10 million square meters per year. In 1999, we almost doubled our capacities up to 17 million square meters per year. A picture from our premises, which we took over after our former mother company, Attix, went bankrupt. In 2002, after the bankruptcy of our former mother company, Knauf took over the remaining 50%. And as I said before, from 2002 onwards, we were 100% subsidiary of Knauf, which was of high value to us because Knauf's policy is to reinvest. Whatever is earned in the company during the year gets reinvested into new technologies, new machinery, new developments. Whereas before, AMF was more or less private owned, and this was for us always a big hurdle or burden, because the owners wanted to see money at the end of the year, and this created a big lack in our pockets to reinvest. In 2003, we started investment into our second plant. So the site which you see over there consists nowadays of two plants. This gives a special assurance. It's, by the way, our only manufacturing facility. All the products which we offer, which we sell into all the countries, are coming from Germany. At these premises, we have got two plants, a total capacity of nowadays 65 million square meters. Both factories running independent from each other. So in the unlikely event of a major shutdown from one factory, we can still produce and serve all our outstanding orders. Since 2011, we also started to produce our own grid at these premises. And in 2013, we took further acquisitions when we bought the manufacturer of a wood wool material called Hera Design. So again, in short, our headquarters in Grafenau, then a few facts, a few milestones, or a few facts. 65 million square meters of capacity for ceiling tiles, 220 million linear meters for grid, more than 600 employees nowadays. We deliver into 90 countries worldwide, of course, including India. I was just mentioning to some of you that in India, we are presented since more than 10 years now, so we have got some experience in the Indian market, and we also have got some history in the Indian market. We maintain 30 branches worldwide, which means under branches we understand special consultancy offices. We have offices in India, for instance. Our main office is based in Mumbai, and then we have further offices in all the major cities to provide service to our clients. Not just to sell the product, but the product goes alongside with suitable service to make sure the product itself is not just delivered in good condition, but also installed in good condition. These are the two production sites nowadays. This is based in Grafenau in Germany. It's on the corner of the three countries, Germany, Austria, and Czech Republic. And then we have got our second plant for wood fiber material. This is based in Ferndorf in Carinthia, Austria, also in a three-corner part. This is very close to the Slovenian and to the Italian border. Let's keep this as of now for the history. If somebody's interested more in history, we are here for the entire evening, so we can give further information on this. I think more interesting for today's evening is what we offer. We offer, as AMF, of course, our corporate brand AMF, Then our three product brands, which I was mentioning before. AMF Thermatex. Thermatex consists of mineral fiber material produced on a wet felt process. Then the AMF Ventatec, which is our grid system. And Hera Design is our wood wool, or are our wood wool products. Our target is, of course, the one or the other was mentioning it this afternoon, volumes, 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 but volumes is not the only one. I mean, we are also interested to provide a good service. And a good service should go to various target groups. And under target groups, we understand architects, planners, consultants, and also specialist or specialized traders. Our know-how is focused on various key points or topics. Sound protection, fire protection, which is one of the key points for tonight's panel discussion. Health and hygiene is becoming more and more important. Material and design is also becoming more and more important. Investors and architects getting sick of this white, boring ceiling. They want to bring some color into the buildings. And of course, sound, light, and e-tech is a topic which enjoys more and more attention. Let's go through the different headlines and give some key factors. When we talk about sound protection, we can come up with a product range which goes up to an absorption value of Alpha W or NRC 1.0. So we cover the entire range from a reflecting board up to an A absorber. All these absorption classes are following different standards. We are following, of course, the ISO standards, but also the American standards, the ASTM C423, for instance. Then sound protection does not just mean sound absorption for us. Sound protection means also sound attenuation, flanking from room to room. Fire protection, a very important factor. In our brief discussion outside, we mentioned a few cases, a few bad stories which recently happened in India when some fire came up and lots of people got injured. Our material is, or let's say all our mineral fiber materials are classified as non-combustible. We can provide fire resistance class up to 120 minutes, especially for corridors, very important, because corridors are important exits in case of fire. Then there is a further categorization from structural fire protection and independent fire protection. The independent fire protection is mainly used in Europe, whereas structural fire protection also affects the Indian market. And as I said before, all our products are tested and under surveillance or under observation from national as well as international organizations. Health and hygiene, another big topic. In our range, we have today special products which comply to clean room certifications from ISO standards 3, 4, 6, as per ISO 14644. We have washable ceilings, which was something which nobody would think of a few years back. I mean, if you see that the material is made out of clay, starch, perlite, and rock wool, it's not normal that you get products which are damp, washable, or also ready for pressure cleaning. Humidity up to RH100 is also possible nowadays. Then we have got special products which are equipped with a special hygienic treatment, which means we will stop growth of bacterial and fungistatic issues. Material and design, as I mentioned before, is becoming more and more important to get special aspects on the ceiling. We can do special surface patterns which are substitute or similar to metal, timber, or individual motifs. The same is also possible for our Hera Design woodwork material. And then the last point, sound, light, and E-Tech. We have got special beamer system which vanishes inside the cavity and makes a closed or provides a closed ceiling. Special lights which are included in the ceilings. Lights are also an upcoming topic. With lights you can heavily influence the atmosphere in the rooms. And sound mosaic. Sound mosaic is a special speaker system which allows special announcements, background music whatsoever, without any cutouts or holes in the ceiling. So it's a non-visible system which provides perfect sound. The product range itself, again, mineral fiber, consists of biosoluble mineral wool. This is also one of the key aspects. Biosoluble or biodegradable is something which is uniquely coming from AMF. Our opposition is using some other materials, some other raw materials as far as the wool is concerned. Then we're also using perlite, clay, and starch. The entire material is produced in a wet fill process. Fire safety we already talked about. Various ceiling designs. I mean, we have more than 38 different surface designs and endless edge details. The Ventatec grid itself has also come up with some unique characteristics. It's a special galvanized steel with special stainless steel connectors. We have got some samples in the back, so if you want to test the lock-in or the lock process, this is something which is very unique as well. We come up with a full system coverage, tile and grid package. And of course, for this tile and grid package, we also provide special warranties, which are more and more requested by the customers. Last but not least, the Hera Design range, made out of wood wool and magnesite. This is also available as ceiling tiles, baffles, wall absorbers, ceiling rafts. These products are used for different applications. One of the applications are educations, universities, schools, then sports facilities, gyms, of course, office places, open plenum offices, cinemas, indoor pools for leisure activities, hospitals, third stop with our journey, what we rely on. We rely on environmental protection. When we talk about environmental protection, we mean different processes which are integrated into our manufacturing process. The entire process is certified as per ISO 14001. We take care about our raw materials, transport. All raw materials which we use for production of our mineral fiber tiles are sourced in a circle of maximum 500 kilometers from production site to make sure carbon emissions are as low as possible. Recycling is an issue which is coming up more and more. We are in a situation that we can recycle used tiles from job sites. We can take the tiles back, recycle it in our production facility, and reuse for new tiles. And then, of course, all the different certifications. I think in India is LEED, one of the leading structures, whereas in other countries there are other local standards, but all of them are more or less under the roof of GEN, or the umbrella of GEN, which means Global Environmental Networking. Environmental protection means that we produce environmental friendly products. Our products are sustainable, 100% recyclable. Manufacturing, of course, with careful use of fossil fuels. All our drying facilities are heated with natural gas. Recycling and reutilization, I already discussed. Our products are certified to various national and international standards. We are subscribing to Singapore Green Label, Taiwan Green Label. In Australia, there is this Good Environmental Choice Australia. All these are local standards and norms which we are follow. Another main criteria, another main label which we follow is the Blue Angel. I think Blue Angel is known by the one or the other. And we also follow a special social engagement. We had some questions prior to this meeting today about trainings. We have got a facility in Grafenau which fits more than 600 guests, and this is equipped with various showrooms and seminar rooms, and over the year we have more than 3,000 guests coming to Germany, visiting our facility, getting in-depth training sessions, plant visits, and also the opportunity to put hands-on and install ceilings themselves, which is very important. As I said at the beginning, the product itself, or the best quality of the product, is useless when it's not installed proper. So our mission is not just to produce high-quality products, but also give an adequate or suitable service to make sure the products are installed high quality. And then, of course, we're also going outside the country and going on trade fairs and other exhibitions to make sure that our products are well known in all these countries. Some new things in our range. We have got the acoustic range. As I said before, in our portfolio, we can come up with products from reflecting material up to an air absorber. For a long time, this was only possible when you had smooth surfaces or fissured surfaces. Nowadays, we have a special fleece-coated range called acoustic range. The surface itself is homogeneous. The visitor or the guest itself, when you stand underneath, you will not locate whether it's this or this material, because, as I said, the surface itself is homogeneous, but the characteristics, the acoustic performance of the tile, can be adjusted by different product formulas or different treatments, density, special perforation underneath the fleece. Ceiling rafts are getting more and more important. We had the one or the other discussion about chilled beam systems or activated concrete systems. And of course, these new systems for climate does not consider acoustics. So to improve the acoustic situation, we have come up with some special acoustic rafts, ceiling rafts, which can be easily installed underneath plasterboard or concrete to improve the acoustic environment in specific rooms. The ceiling rafts itself are equipped with different options. You can get it flat ones, curved ones, convex, concave, different colors to bring some pep into the rooms, flexible sizes, special shapes. Another option to improve acoustics in the rooms are wall absorbers. If the ceiling itself, the volume of the ceiling itself, does not absorb enough sound, there are still spaces left in the rooms where you can improve the absorption value. And one of these are wall absorbers. Wall absorbers can be equipped as nice pictures, nice designs, and do not just contribute to the acoustics, but also to the atmosphere itself, to the optical atmosphere inside the rooms. Then, as I said before, the Aquatec range, which is a product which is RH100 washable. The Varioline product, it's a special range where we can print whatever you could think of onto the ceiling. And the last stop for today, references. I was promising some references from all over the world. Here we have got a special office building in Germany, another one in Netherlands. I think Harley-Davidson is familiar to everybody. Harley-Davidson has used special ceiling rafts made out of wood wool, our wood wool ceiling. Then in UK, it's an academy using various products. These are the baffles, which I was introducing before, made out of wood wool. This is one of our latest reference projects. And it's a very nice one. Then here we have got the arena in Belarus using a special acoustic product called Thermophone. The AVB tower in Netherlands. This is a special product because they were using wood wool material, but I'm not sure if you can see it on the picture. The wood wool itself got a special treatment. They put special wordings inside the ceiling by cutting it with a CNC cutter. Then ceiling islands to improve acoustics inside a hair salon. Oracle Netherlands using bound raster systems for open space offices. A school in Berlin using Sonic Sky ceiling rafts. Then Blitz Cinema Blitz Megaplex cinemas in Indonesia. A bowling center in Ukraine using the wood wool material for wall absorbers. Yeah, and here we are at the final destination. I mentioned it before. The one or the other might think now, why is he here standing in front of us, being in India and not providing any Indian reference projects? It's very hard for us to get reference pictures for Indian projects. To get permission to take pictures is close to impossible. We have books full of references, but no pictures. And I think it's better to have references with pictures than just the names. So if somebody is interested in the names itself, our team can, of course, provide it. Right. If there are some questions, I'm here later on as well. Thank you very much for your attention. And now I'm happy to hand over to the team. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Riedel, for this informative presentation. And I now call upon our distinguished panel to come onto the stage. We start with Mr. S.K. Nandi. He's the principal at C.P. Kukreja & Associates, a multidisciplinary architectural and engineering firm, and he has nearly 40 years' experience in various types of major civil and structural engineering projects in India and the UK. Mr. Nandi. Mr. A.K. Sharma, the director of the Delhi Fire Services, and Mr. Sharma has over 30 years of experience in this profession. Please. We have architect Tarun Valecha. He's the director of the design firm R.L. Valecha and Associates Private Limited, and in his career spanning over 20 years, he has focused on the technologically advanced and sustainable architectural. So, Mr. And we have Mr. Tony D'Souza, Director Operations of Knauf AMF India. He has over 25 years' experience in the building construction industry, with 15 years in the air condition industry before that. Mr. Tony. Thank you, sirs. And I now hand over the mic to Mr. S.K. Nandi. If you could please start the panel discussion.
Good evening. They are German products. So it's German products are excellent products. So, but unfortunately or fortunately, the topic of the subject of the discussion today is aesthetic and safety aspect of interior ceilings and wall systems. So there is a concern regarding the fire protection of an interior. So we talk about buildings. We talk about a building as a whole, how well it is protected against a fire. You know, the different elements of buildings are protected against fire. We have fire resistance of 1 hour, 2 hours. All accesses and exit points have fire ratings. So all the doors have to be 2 hours rating. The walls have to be certain ratings. Fine. But when the interior designer comes, and according to the client's wishes, the client's requirements, designs a premises, an office, or it can be a hospital even, or an auditorium. What happens? At the end of the day, is the entire system, entire building, which you are talking about, how well it is protected against the fire. Is the false ceiling which has been put in the building, is it fire resistant? Does it have an integrity when there is a fire which breaks? How long it can sustain itself, whether it can sustain for half an hour or 1 hour, by the time the people can be evacuated. No one discusses these points. We are only discussing the interior design and the final product. But what happens to the fire safety norms? You know? So this is the topic of discussion today. And with that reference, you know, I would like to hand over to Mr. Sharma to say something about the fire safety norms of the interior of office buildings or interior of any building, you know, to any modern building.
Good evening, every one of you here. Before I say something, today is Women's Day, and I see quite a few women out there. And let me wish you all a very happy Women's Day to start with. Mr. Nandi was talking, and I thought my job is made much more easier. We spoke almost everything with respect to fire safety. Looking at the presentation, part of it which has been made, I was quite happy to understand when I read the word or saw the word that is a flame, non-combustible material are being used. Unfortunately, I'll put it this way, we have standards, norm, practices, understandings. The code of practice clearly brings out that all buildings shall be planned, designed, constructed, maintained so as to ensure fire and life safety, and let me put it the other way around, the life and fire safety. We should be more concerned about life first and then followed by fire safety. Add to it the trauma when gets or passed through. I would like to recall a fire which took place 20, 25 years down the line, Upahar, and it is still raging or burning. We had a Supreme Court judgment 3 days back. So the issues are not yet settled with respect to an incident which has taken 20 years down the line. Whatever may be the reason, maybe lack of fire safety, maybe otherwise. We had other incidents in the country which rocked our awareness. Fire at Amri lost 98 people, Calcutta hospital fire, which Mr. Nandi, when he's talked about hospitals. We had Mantralaya fire at Mumbai last year, where almost entire building was gutted. Are we talking of buildings with non-combustible constructions, materials with low flame spread, with fire resistance materials put in there? Then why these incidents are happening at all? Or if they are happening, why they are not being brought under control within a reasonable period of time without loss of life and property thereafter? So, architects out there, we as enforcer, we have to, we need each other. We have to work together to ensure that these structures, whatever you plan as an architect basically, you design those buildings, you make sure these are constructed to those certain specifications, and these are serviced by a service provider, and we pitch in where a law enforcing agency keep a check on it. Okay, buildings are meeting to a certain minimum standards which are being laid down. Apart from the response mechanism of fighting the fire in case accident take place. Having said so, I would say that the specifications are very clear, the codes are very clear, and they are being upgraded time and again. Looking at various experience we go through or learn in the process as we progress in life. Buildings, shells are constructed, non-combustible material, load-bearing structures, non-combustible material, partitions, partially non-combustible material. The problems comes in when we are talking of other fitments, the interior designs, as rightly has been put in, comes into play. Aesthetics of buildings play much more important role or overshadows the life safety aspects of it. right, left, and center, products which gives out toxic fumes, which are flammable, which are combustible, are being used, and used extensively by interior designers. This basically creates havoc for we people when we come for, when we give a response in case of an emergency. False ceilings giving way, draperies burning freely, you can see the layer of smoke on the false ceiling from one end of the corridor to the another end of the corridor when we come in with our fire hoses. One can always see the draperies burning and burning freely. So there have to be a stricter control within ourselves to meet those requirements which are being laid down. And let me put it very clearly that there are norms which are available, which are in the code of practices, which needs to be followed. I think fire safety and life safety, it's a job which we all have to share together. It's not only our job as a fire department per se, but it is a shared responsibility with all the people who pitch in to see that a building is sustained, not only erected, but it is sustainable over a period of time. Thank you. And any questions? Yes, I'd love to have.
May I just explain, what happens to, how do you have a fire in there, In a building, how does a fire take place, There has to be materials which is prone to fire. That's one thing. Then there has to be, of course, oxygen. And there has to be, that means, there are three things which causes a fire in a building. One is definitely the source of fire, which may be a short circuit or electric problem, or can be from a kitchen, can be from a pantry, or then the oxygen, which is always there. And the third thing, which is the presence of combustible material within the vicinity of the source of fire. Now, if the materials which are in and around you, within the building, if they are fire resistant or if they are non-combustible, then where does the fire take place? It is impossible to have a fire if there are non-combustible materials all around you. So the first and primary thing to have your environment built, that means your office interior built with materials as far as possible with non-combustible materials. So that is one of the primary important thing. And what is a fire? What are the two aspects of a fire? One is the reaction to the fire and the resistance to the fire. What is the reaction to the fire? Let us see what is the reaction. See, I'm explaining what happens to a fire. The reaction to the fire is essentially combustible. The burning, the surface burning of materials and the speed at which it spreads all around. That is the reaction to the fire of any material. And the resistance is exactly opposite to that. The resistance is the rate at which within a standard time that the fire is prevented from spreading from one area to the other area. So there are two aspects to a fire. So any design of fireproofing is based on these two principles. That means you have to design with the building environment, in interior of a building, as much as possible with non-combustible materials or materials which has a longer fire resistance. That means at least 1 hour or 2 hours. So that means the question comes, what is the fire resistance? There. So this is the question you can ask, there, because it's very important that, you see, you just heard from Mr. Riddle, a beautiful presentation of his products and other things. Now, the products are very beautiful. There's no doubt about it. Germans never make bad products. Now, if good products, the excellent products, are used badly or installed badly, then what is the use of those products? Then you are inviting fire. You are inviting problems. Because there may be or there may not be a source of fire. There will be some source of fire. You know, there can be accidents at night. There can be a problem of short circuit. So what happens to it? How do we achieve that, the integrity of the system? See, his product is also a false ceiling product. So this is a false ceiling. And there is a fire in this room, you know, at night. What happens to it? Does the false ceiling sustain itself for 1 hour or 2 hours by the time the people are vacated? Or does the false ceiling fall down as soon as the fire takes place? So that is the question I'm asking you. That means it is the installation of the system also is extremely important. You know, there, you know. So what we are discussing is a system of false ceiling, a system of balcony. It is not one material. False ceiling are panels, false ceilings are also suspended with grids. It has to be supported. Now, we talk about two materials now. So the entire thing is called false ceiling. So how do we achieve the integrity of this system? Say 1 hour or 2 hours of that, it does not break, it does not fall down. See, if it is, see the structure, just imagine the brick walls are designed for 2 hours already. The concrete, the roof is, you know, it's sustainable because it has also a good fire resistance. Columns are, the structure is has got a good, very high fire resistance. So then what happens? Does the false ceiling sustain itself? Does it remain where it has been designed to remain? Or it starts falling down immediately when the fire takes place? That is the question. So the responsibility of the system provider, that means the false ceiling provider, there is an added responsibility in India. Like that, we have a grid which suspends the false ceiling. Do we design the grid properly along with the false ceiling? That is the question. Now in India, you see, the false ceiling is something which is, you know, awarded to a contractor or, you know, it's given to a client, you know, there, you know, given by a client to do this job. Now, the grid, you all know, you are all architects. Now, a false ceiling fully installed, a mineral fiber false ceiling, can cost up to 900 to 1,000 rupees per square meter. Out of this, the grid can cost 100 rupees, 200 rupees, or 300 rupees. Now, if I have a proper grid with fire notches, they can cost up to 300 per square meter. That means the 900 rupees becomes 1100 rupees per square meter. Are you, as architects, responsible enough to recommend to the clients, or bold enough to put it in the specification of your tender that, look, you have to provide this strong grid with panels, 3 meter grid with fire notches. This is the AMF specification. This is the German specification. This is the specification of the Armstrong UK. But in more than 99 cases, almost 100 cases, out of 100 cases, the grid is pathetic in India. The suspension grid, that means it is within 100 rupees per square meter. So to start with, we are irresponsible. And we are inviting problem. That means as soon as the fire takes place, the whole suspension system falls down. So where is the safety aspect? So I've been discussing with this AMA people that you have an added responsibility. So you provide us with the installation system. You make us sure that we provide the grid. You know, this is one of the examples I'm giving you, you know, there. It's exactly the same thing. What kind of insulation you provide above the false ceiling? You know, there. Do you provide thermocol? Do you provide polyurethane foam? Because they are easy to obtain then. But both, as soon as the fire takes place, both spread toxic gases to the extent that they can kill people. Don't forget that it's the smoke which kills more people than actual fire. So this is the question I'm asking the manufacturers. They say, be responsible. Provide us with all the specifications, all the guidelines of installation system. And what are the good things, what are the bad things? So we also incorporate in the specification as consultants and as architects. And then we see, maybe out of 100, at the beginning we are successful in 60, 70 cases. But with the coming of more and more PMC companies within the construction frame today, I think we will be able to be successful in the near future.
Good evening, everyone. Mr. Nandi and Mr. Sharma has actually covered most aspect of it, so there's not really much for me to say. Yes, of course, there's a little bit of blame that does come on the architects for the fact that we probably are considered to be more sensitive towards aesthetic rather than the safety or other crucial factors which should be ideally focused upon as well. I would only add to it that, you know, yes, it largely works as a team where we as architects and our consultants, we can bring forward and try and impose it on the client. But at times, yes, it does get compromised for whatever commercial factors or the reason the client may choose, which becomes a limiting factor. At the same time, it's also at times the problem that comes across in many of a project is lack of awareness about the availability of the product and things like this. And over this discussion that we were having with AMF people, when we see these newer products coming which highlight on various aspects of safety clubbed with aesthetics, of course that kind of takes care of most of our concerns. And as an architect, our comfort level also gets extended that we know the product that we are recommending to our client does cater to our aesthetic sensibilities and at the same time is not really compromising on any of the safety part of it. At the end of it, as consultants, as design consultants, as services consultants, our job at times does kind of get restricted to specifying and suggesting and, you know, There's a larger aspect of it which also kind of gets to the last end of the chain, and that is about execution, which sometimes gets overlooked or ignored. And that's where, unfortunately, we kind of, you know, sometimes fall short of really exercising our control. Because particularly nowadays that we see the profession or the entire exercise of construction is de-linked, and, or rather say decentralized, and architect's role kind of gets curtailed to offering drawings and specification documents, and somebody else as a PMC is taking care of execution or various other segments that we look at. End of the day, it's critical that it is the entire process becomes foolproof, and there is a bit of a consciousness that is required from each of the participants in this span of the process, whether that is the client himself who's probably keen to pitch in that extra money and spend for his safety and his, you know, people's safety. One of the important things that we see nowadays, particularly related to the interior product, is the is the lifespan that one is looking at as a client. What happens is that, you know, most of the rate of growth that we see with the companies, they move in and move out of offices in maybe 2-3 years. You know, they want to expand or they want to just do away with it. So there, they, when they look at a ROI, return on investment, is that okay? They are investing X amount in a certain office project or whatever. So that probably becomes a criteria in back of their mind, and they would rather save on something knowing that, okay, they're not going to use it for longer than 2-3 years. And compromising any unforeseen accident, which obviously doesn't work with a time limit, it could just happen any time. Yes, with the availability of these newer products that we just saw in this presentation, which are emphasizing a lot and kind of exceeding the boundaries of aesthetics, giving us newer designs, like these grid ceilings are not like those boring grid ceilings anymore. They are adding curves and they are adding various other profiles to it, which gives us as an architect an exciting option. At the same time, they are also exceeding the boundaries of safety measures and, you know, their functionality in terms of sound absorption and something, which I'm sure can, you know, just offer us a better product towards everything that we are concerned about. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Valecha. I would thank both of you for throwing out so many challenges to the ceiling manufacturers, and I think it's apt for us to answer these questions one by one, though it could not be very, very detailed. But I've made a few points which I caught up during this conversation. A few of them, which I made a notes of, I think safety is prime. So safety becomes the top of my list. There is also a need for modernization all the time. Like you made a comment that you are getting into newer products, but they should also look different. The same old thing again and again doesn't work for a very, very long period. So people need a change, and we have to take the responsibility of introducing the change into the market. A very important point, another important point rather, was the control over the installation process, and this looks to be a very, very big concern around the team here. I will come to this later. Integrity of the installation, together with ensuring that it becomes easy to handle after the installer leaves the space, so that if he has some maintenance, whatever the person does to access something on top of the ceiling, he needs to put back the ceiling into place in a manner that the integrity of the ceiling remains, aesthetically as well as in terms of safety. I put this down to approach which is simple when we even select the material for making the basic selection of how we produce these products. I would put it to selection of the material, application of the material, and finally the maintenance. These 3 points. One of the most important factors which also brought into discussion was non-combustible material rather, and also the issue of VOC-free, which is now being talked about. And what happens to the product when it is exposed to fire? Does it give out smoke? We as manufacturers can claim a lot because a lot of manufacturers talk about most of these subjects again and again. But I think the best way to put the best foot forward is to commit yourself by exposing yourself to third-party strictures. When the third party says that you have done a test, a third party like UL, for example, all our products are, we ensure that all our products are UL certified for zero smoke spread. Not reduced smoke spread, but zero smoke spread. And we have a third-party certificate for this. We ensure that we do not deal with any material which is less than A2S1D0, which means at 1,700 degrees, exposure to 1,007 degrees of fire, the product will not give out any smoke. The product will not, you will not even have droplets coming down. And this we achieve by introducing clay into the product. And each of us know how clay works. The more you heat it, the more stronger it becomes. And the clay is the particle element in the tile which ensures that it keeps the tile together. Which brings us back to how is this tile installed on what kind of a system? Here, of course, there are different methods used, and there are some changes which we would take pride in saying we introduce in the system. For example, about a decade back, all we could see is the 600 by 600 or what we classically call as the 2x2 tile. We went a step ahead and we introduced the 1800 by 300. And the format was introduced in a manner to keep in keeping in mind the safety of corridors or escape routes. What one would call corridors, I would always call them as safety, escape routes, because that is the place people would use to run away from the place when there is a fire. So why depend on a grid system in an escape route? Why not look for an alternative? And the alternative was, we can make single planks of 2.5 meters by 300 mm, and they are installed end to end on a corridor without a suspension in the middle. So whether the fire occurs on top of the ceiling or below the ceiling, there is no way the ceiling drops, giving you enough time to escape from the place, also giving you enough time protection of the soffit, as much as 30 minutes to 120 minutes as Andreas put in his presentation. So this is a step forward, and there are a lot of institutions, both public and private now, opting for more and more system F, which are these planks, to at least at the first step keep the corridors free. Having said this, toxic fumes was another subject, and I don't know if you caught it when Andreas said that we use just four things in our tile. Mineral wool made out of basalt rock, so it is basically rock. Starch, perlite, and clay. There is no fifth element in this. Of course, we use a little bit of paper, but this is very less, to the extent of not more than 4 to 5%. The formation of the tile is such that it cannot give any toxic fumes. The chalk, the paint that we use is not acrylate dispersion. It is chalk. It is a color made by ourselves. We don't depend on anybody else to make this color for us. It is purely water-based. And therefore, when the tile is exposed to the fire, it doesn't have any acrylate dispersion to give out smoke. These are steps taken by us to ensure that we contribute positively to the industry. Of course, there is a long way to go. We have certain challenges, because there are, for example, if I have to address Hera Design as a product, the wood wool, you will realize that the wood itself is not very good for fire. But we do not recommend, or we do not suggest people use these products in huge quantities in large areas. They are for acoustic specialties, for something that you need to achieve which you cannot achieve with regular material. Let's say a recording studio. What is prime there is getting low frequency, very short reverberation on low frequency. Wood wool is one of the best materials to achieve this. The same in high volume areas where you need lesser reverberation time. And these places, of course, we have also taken wood wool to the extent of getting it rated 8.2. And this we achieve by coating sand on every strand of the wood wool to give us better fire safety. All these options are possible, but as we drag into these options, higher cost leads to the customer taking a decision. The customer has to take a decision of finally what he wants to use in the place. I think the message we take from here is we need to contribute a lot towards the installation process, and this is where I think the major concern is. And also to ensure that we provide a system and not a tile. This is a point we will carry, and we are trying our own methods to integrate this. For example, like I told you outside, we are very strict on issuing warranty certificates. If anybody in the channel tries to mix up our approved tiles without our approved grids, this is one way. The other way is to get a platform like this where we can address the platform and tell people how we operate, what products we have, and how they should look at a system rather than a mineral fiber ceiling tile. please, if you have any questions, we would be very happy to answer them.
I have one of the first questions to Mr. D'Souza. You just mentioned that in corridors you can have 2.4 by 0.3. That's fine. That sounds very nice, you know. But you see, in hospitals and in hotels, the corridors carry a lot of services above the fall ceiling. In fact, most of the services. So these fall ceilings are opened almost on a daily basis. So what happens, you know, if you have longer panels, and this is a very practical experience, you know, the alignment will never be the same the next day. So how do you ensure that?
The system is such that every tile is removable. Every tile is removable, and it is self-aligning. It cannot sit in any other direction because the edges are made in such a way that they...
You have installed and gone. You know, your installer has gone. So it's the maintenance people who will be taking over in the hotel or the hospital. 99% services are over the corridor ceiling. Trust me. And they're open every 2 hours or 3 hours because there are some problems every time. Either the network problem, or the air conditioning problem, or the water problem, something or other. So you have to open the ceilings, maybe two panels, maybe three panels, maybe four panels. And it's never the same when they're put back by the maintenance guy, you know, there. You know. And this is why we have gone back to 600 by 600. Trust me, this is the problem.
I can answer that. The only analogy I can give is, I think we all know about this. Audio tapes we used to put inside the cassette player, no? You can only put it one way. Huh? There is no other way you can put it in. So these tiles are made in such a way that you can put it only in one way. You cannot put it in any other way. And they will perfectly fit only within that slot. Even after you remove, it doesn't matter whether you remove two or you remove four or you remove eight. It has been made, the edges have been made to be user friendly.
I think I'll invite Mr. D'Souza to one of our projects to have it installed.
Thank you, sir. This gives me an opportunity.
Very soon, maybe within a month.
By the second or the third year of professional practice wants to set up his own firm.
Absolutely.
And then there is nobody to tell him. So where does the education system go when we're talking about something like this? When I was in the first year, I was told about the break. Of course, there was Adobe ready available, but Adobe is not that good, as good as break. So I was told about the break. But I was never told about the ceiling. In fact, it was very late. I've been practicing for 17 years now, and it was very late that I realized that the ceiling should also be fireproof.
May I just answer this?
Sir.
Yeah. The problem lies with the suppliers, the manufacturers. In other countries, particularly the European countries, there are standards set up. There are standards, you know, you just have to look at the net or look at their manual. The installation system is there. The do's and don'ts are there. You just have to go through that. There aren't any here. Here is so competitive. Armstrong doesn't talk to MF. MF doesn't talk to Armstrong. Why can't they sit together and set up this installation procedure for everyone? I've been trying to have this for tiling, for tile installation system. So I call Kajaria. I call Somani. I call Johnson. They don't talk. This just spit fire.
So why should they talk?
So that's the problem. But in Europe, they talk to each other. There are standards. There are manuals. That is the whole problem. If they can establish the system, if the suppliers of the false ceilings, two or three, AMF and Armstrong, sit together for the benefit of us, benefit of the users, the customers, the students. Everything is solved. They will not do it.
I think it won't take much time if you simply take some time off and go to SPA or any of these colleges around the entire country and just take a give a 1 hour brief.
Yeah.
On that is that. The fire protection.
See, what apart from what Mr. Nandi said, the question basically was relating to the education system. Per se, in SPA or whatever school of architects we have all over the country. I do agree with it. We do need such sort of introduction of a subject per se, or talk, as you have said. As far as Delhi experience is concerned, I can vouch we have been invited in SPA and we have been going around there. My other officers are also going. And we do whatever best we can as a young architect who are there passing through that phase of life, education. And whenever these young architects, as you put it, it took so many years for you to understand about the non-combustibility, why it is required for the ceiling. We have a committee in Delhi Fire Service where I'm sure I remember quite a few faces here must have come across us when they come in there with the projects. We discuss with open hearts what exactly is the problem and how people, architect comes to us with certain design and said, okay, look, this is what basically is required, needs to be changed. And that, I think, is a part of an education system per se, which we try to put forward. But I do agree on what you have said. We do need to take this subject per se into the curriculum of the architectural field as such. Yes, I do agree.
I'll just add to this, if the institution, SPA or Sushant School or whatever, if they invite manufacturers, suppliers, and also the various departments like fire services, I think they would be too happy to participate. And I remember many years back, I used to teach in Sushant School. And I'm a structural engineer and civil engineer. I never taught structural engineering. You can be taught from books. The subject is not that difficult. But what I taught was materials. Materials are because it's the most neglected subject. And I found that, we used to, every 15 days, we'd call a supplier, whether it be a false ceiling, or be, bricks, or be tile manufacturers. We would go visit their production units, see the entire system of production, and spend half a day or one day. It depends on the institute, mind you. If they can cooperate, and if you can spare the students in this, this exercises or the things, I think it would be great. I don't think the suppliers, the manufacturers will ever say no. Just as then you can try this exercise.
A candid confession, we never tried this. Okay, this rings a bell in my mind. This, when I was doing when I was in the air conditioning industry, we used to do this very, very often. It struck me, why we are not doing this now? Because we can also get into the mind of the students, commercially speaking. This is possible. Having said this, I would tell you what we are doing in south of India, mostly predominantly, the architecture institutions or the architecture business is very, very large. They come in big packages in the south. 40 architects in one office. Huge. Huh? And these architecture companies have, let's say, slotted times out. Once every Saturday in a month, they are not working at all. They slot it out for 4 or 5 manufacturers. And we often go there to most of these institutes. Sometimes we call them out. Sometimes we go to their office itself where they have their training rooms. And we present the products. And that is where the new architects who have just joined this business get exposed to the product per se. But yes, catch them young. Why should you wait till they join office? So, Andreas, we should look at a possibility of having a package of, or making it a habit or some system where we evaluate ourselves and say, have we done 2 hours of training in some college once in 3 months, maybe for a start, huh? And we have enough colleges here to contribute, really. So, thank you, sir.
We have been talking here about the fire safety norms and other things from the acoustic materials or other material. The other aspect which is very important while specifying the materials in general office buildings and special auditoriums, multiplexes and other things, is also acoustics, which is not becoming part of the discussion, actually. It has to be, you are giving us products where the NRC values, you are talking other things, but where is the selection process of what NRC, what at what stage, who is deciding on that? Unless we go for the specifications, preferably depending on what areas we are choosing, probably we will not be able to do justice with the products which we are producing. So there has to be information on that aspect also, in addition to the fire safety norms.
In the product manual.
Yes.
Sir, I would like to take that. Acoustics, as you know, you must know more than anybody else, is a very, very complex subject. And we are trying to deal with this with only one aspect, which is the ceiling. Because, let's say, most of the time, only when you talk about ceilings do people consider us NRC or sound attenuation. It is much more than this. Commercially speaking, we are at a stage when we are filling a tender and the nail is already in the coffin. If the architects request for a 0.7 and I say, no, wait a minute, please, 0.6 is the right one here. There is only one standard reaction. Oh, you don't have the 0.7, forget it, stay out. This is no platform for us to go and talk to the architects. I always tell my boys, the right way and the right time to talk to the architect when he has no job on his table. That is the time he will listen to you. And this is the time you can clear the myth. If you see the modern myth of corporate India, 0.9 NRC. This is amazing to us as people or manufacturers of acoustic materials. We are breaking our head trying to tell people that this is no antibiotic, please. 0.9 is used in specific requirements. There are times when we had to uninstall 0.9 and make it 0.6 to make that area work. But the moment we talk about this, we are held collar up, thrown out of the office. So we indulge. I confess that we indulge in following the pack. Because I am trying to be very candid, rather than being very, very bookish about this. If I put any step forward to stop this, we are considered as not being at par. And the whole sentence comes into play. Aap nahi karoge to koi aur karega. This is why I don't believe that you can do this on an open platform. You have to sit with the people one-to-one, build relation with them at the first level, to the level that they come to a trust, and they trust that your skills are enough for him to learn something. And at that point of time, you can open the book. And it is a time-consuming process. We are doing this one by one. Of course, we have a packet of architects who are now listening to us. It's a slow process. But I totally agree with you that acoustic is now a single figure, 0.6, 0.7, and latest fad, 0.9.
It has to be keeping in the space, keeping in the volume, what liveness you require, what functions are going on in that area, the whole thing will depend on that.
That's why I said you know better than me. Yeah. There are instances where we have uninstalled the 0.9
yes.
because it disturbed the concentration of people working inside the place. But when we initially told them, we got thrown out. So this is a complexity. We have to deal with it because we are on one extent in the industry of training people at the same time, and on the other end we have a bottom line to cover, so we are trying to cut this critical balance all the time. But yes, we we need to do a little more.
Yes,
I am in total agreement of this.
Thank you.
It's not really a question. It's more like an issue that I would like to put forward and would like to have an opinion. My issue is regarding the buildings which are being designed as shell and core, primarily shopping centers, shopping malls, office buildings, where we as architects design shell and core, hand it over to the client. Then each tenant or each end user, each individual buyer comes, does his own retrofitting, does his own interiors, hires an architect or an interior designer. And that's where the complexity starts coming in. Because we as architects have designed the building, we've given him the shell. Now some XYZ person comes in, starts doing the interiors. We don't have a check. We don't have a control of what he does, what material he chooses, what specifications he goes for. In that scenario, how do you think, where does the remedy lies? How can we, as a as a collective, because suppose at the end of the day, there's an accident, there's a fire incident, who's to be blamed? I mean, ultimately, it'll be the architect who's signed on the paper,
yes,
who will be caught.
Yes.
But then it's not our fault. Somebody who's choosing the wrong material and, I mean, these interior designers who are, a lot into the practice now without a technical education, without having a bachelor's degree in architecture, or without having a proper knowledge. A lot of these, we all know, let's admit, that they are into the profession.
See, may I just answer this question, that, see, several years back, many years back, in fact, when I came back from England, and I had this confusion, same as yours. When I saw this terrible, the confusion here, in all over the building industries, and there, no specifications, no way. Each one is doing it its own way and other things. I had that dilemma. But gradually, I also became, a little bit, more sober on this issue. I used to get very angry. What the hell, this, I'll go back, This is not the way to construct things. But leaving apart that, I think the responsibility lies with the suppliers, with the manufacturers of the materials. You can't do this in Europe. You can't do in USA. You can't do in Germany, because there are standards are there. I'm telling again and again, we don't have standards. Do we have standards of false ceiling? The installation system, the material? No way. Why can't they get together? Why can't Armstrong get together with AMF? There are others also there, and establish a system, establish the material specifications, which will go into your specifications, my specifications, client specifications, and we can present that the entire volume of specifications of material as a standard. Like when Rajrawal did, where Engineers India office is there. There are architectural control, because you come up place. It's exactly the same way. It's a parallel example. If we have standards of materials, standards of tiles and the installation system of tiles, standards of false ceiling and the installation of false ceiling, why can't we do that? It may take a few years to do that, but the responsibility lies on them. They are selling the product. If the product is very good, it's an international standard. AMF is able to do it in Germany. Why can't they do it in India? This is my question. So we'll all share the responsibility. We'll also help them. I'm prepared to spend time with them. I try to do that with the tile manufacturers, with a dismal failure.
Military authority is very strong. Like here, the fire department should be responsible when you are fitting. They should also comply with the fire norms. Ultimately, somebody has to take the responsibility.
That's why I'm saying it's a teamwork. This is a teamwork. That after having the standards, why can't
they should not certify a empty building? They should certify with fitments.
Exactly.
occupancy should be, it doesn't happen only in the malls, it happens everywhere, even in the hospitals,
yes, it happens. No, you give it
to the third party.
Hospitals are unlikely.
I'm telling you, you give it to third party, some vendor will come, variant, he will do his own things. Nobody is checking what he is doing. But it should be the final occupied property that should be certified as fire safe or not fire safe.
Yes, I agree.
I would like to say something.
I do agree.
The way we have a sanction process for buildings, we should have a sanction process for the ID, interior design, which has just happened to our country 15 years back. Most of the architecture firms have now shifted to interior design practices and so-called interior architecture because they're large-scale interiors. I was in Dubai last week. We were having a corporate, trying to do a corporate alliance with the office there. And in Dubai, it is compulsory to have an interior design sanctioned prior to fit-out. There is a sanction process for ID as well, which I think our country lacks.
I think that's a good
solution. I've been doing multiplexes for last 15 years now, and not a single ID has been sanctioned by any of the government bodies. I think that will put a lot of pressure on the clients not to short-circuit and cut the corners and the costs. Certain things are mandatory and they have to be followed.
But I'm a little surprised at the multiplexes because they belong to international
The architecture
groups.
Is sanctioned,
yeah.
But the interior design, the aesthetics, the materials going into interiors, there is still no sanction process for ID.
Yeah.
Dubai, it is compulsory.
Things cropping up from the enforcing agencies, but when we talk about life safety per se, I do agree the measures we should have a way forward wherein the building as such in a running condition should be certified rather than only a shell certification, which normally is being happening. I can give you an example in multiplexes. Unless it's not a shell certification to the multiplexes, it's the entire, when they are ready for screening the film, then only a certification is given. But then we have to trade off between sort of a third party inspection, the inspector enforcing, too much of enforcing contributions and things like that. I think the way forward is that it has to be entire, when you turn on the key, it has to be certified like that. I do agree.
I think since there are no regulatory bodies, since there are no cross and check, we try to find an easy way out. Since there is nobody certifying our interiors, we try to cut corners. Largely we all know that there are a lot of systematic, drawbacks which are leading to all these. As a matter of fact, even the earlier question that we raised about, students being aware, I slightly differ here with Mr. Nandi that, frankly, it's not a vendor's responsibility to teach you. It's the education system which needs to make sure that the student is taught. Vendor, no matter what, they'll have commercial interests. They'll try to sell as much they can and for whatever you're ready to pay. Trying to be responsible and all, yes, it comes in a package, but then at the same time, they have to look at their own commercial interests. But if as an institute, if as a regulatory educational body, I'm making sure that my students are taught at the right time, they are made aware. So instead of them waiting for a vendor to take initiative, they already know and they will question the vendor. Why should AMF take an initiative or any other brand for that matter? And similarly here, I think we have a large, when we talk about these vacant buildings being licensed, the fact is that these are time-bound licenses and every 2 years they're being renewed. But then we know that they just get renewed. So any other thing, when we are doing most of the thing, for that matter, even if we talk about a building sanction process, how many buildings do really comply with that? We get these. So the point here is much larger that, we really need to, which probably, I don't know if any of us can really contribute to that because we are passive partners to it. And, till the time the authorities kind of take a regular check. If tomorrow I know that if I put a wrong ceiling and if there's a fire and I'll be jacked, I'll be scared. I'll never do it. But when I know I can get away, take my money from the client and be happy, why should I really bother? So it's a vicious circle. I mean, don't know where to catch the goose from, but we are kind of stuck at it.
I think let me just clarify what you said, you know, that when I said about the students, you know, I didn't mean that the vendors will go to them, you know. You have to see how a tile is produced, is false ceiling is produced, or a laminate is produced, you know. If you are able to understand the production system or how it is made, then it is ingrained in your faculty that, okay, this is how a tile is produced or a false ceiling system is made. You know.
I agree with that. That's how I feel. You know, if my faculty, my student, my teachers kind of take a student trip to a factory, so I'll be aware. So
that is what we used to do.
Yeah, so most of the institutes aren't doing that, unfortunately.
Yeah. We used to do that every 10 days.
The education is being just taught to kind of get your passing marks and go through to the next level. I mean, it's really sad, though. It's not really concerning the discussion here, but the education level that we see, the kind of the emphasis is not really upon the education. And, you know, there are so many institutes which are really questionable, actually.
None of the curriculums actually mention fire. No.
Yeah, they do.
There is no mention of
fire. So that's what I mean. The basic premise is totally absurd.
There is another suggestion that, like in Dubai, from where he's coming, you have a value on a human life. So, spotting somebody gets killed, you have to pay X amount of money.
Obligation on the traffic rules as well as in the fire rules.
You know, that envelope needs to be tightened. So when I know my stakes are higher, but when I'm on the other end, when I see that I can get away, then why should I care?
No, you can start with that.
Very small thing, you cross a traffic signal here without thinking twice. You try and if we only travel abroad anywhere, we'll be shit scared, we'll never cross it. Because we know that what it means. And people living there also know what it means, so they'll never do it. You know, one punch on your license and you're gone. Now here, you so throw the license away, you get 10 more licenses tomorrow.
Let's start putting value on Indian human life.
Well, that's the same. The problem is we have to start somewhere. Right. You know, that's what we are discussing. If we take everything for granted that we can't do it, that's about it.
Any other questions for us to take? Okay, thank you to our distinguished panel and all of you for this interesting and enlightening, actually, discussion which we had. And I'd like you to continue this discussion and interaction over some cocktails and dinner. And please continue this. And on behalf of BuildoTech and Knopf AMF, I would like to thank all our panel members and all of you for this wonderful discussion. Thank you so much and have a wonderful evening.